podcast for construction owners, contractors, and insurance professionals, where you can hear from the experts about tips to help you be successful. My name is Peter Duggan. I'm president and CEO of Proactive. I'm here with my co-host, Mike Diercksen, senior innovation and content solutions consultant, and our featured guest, one of the industry's leading subcontractor default insurance experts, Bill Lane. Bill is a risk manager for Hudson Insurance Group and is a true specialist in the SDI market space. Bill, how are you doing today?
Fantastic, Peter. Thank you. Appreciate you and the Proactive team having me today. I'm really excited to be talking with you guys about something I'm really passionate about.
Awesome. And Mike, how are you doing this morning?
Doing great, Peter. Really excited to have Bill on. And Bill, thanks for joining us.
Bill, our topic today is essential steps for contractors to improve your subcontractor prequalification. Before we get into that main topic, can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you got to where you are now?
Absolutely. So I've been in the construction industry for about 18 years or so. Most of that was tenure with a small GC out of Baltimore, Maryland. A lot of folks may or may not have heard of them, called Whiting Turner. I started out as an entry-level project engineer for them, you know, doing the ordinary but important tasks of all of the operational elements associated with the life cycle of delivering a construction project. So collecting prequalification, you know, doing scoping, doing budgeting, doing scheduling, doing subcontract management, payment applications, you know, all of the administrative and operational responsibilities. So throughout my time there, I was able to grow into a project management role and be responsible for doing all of those things with a team of my own. So I have a deep appreciation for what it takes to deliver all of the multiple risk facets of a construction project to the various stakeholders, subcontractors on one side, owners on the other. So again, deep appreciation for that. But throughout some of that, I was able to make an introduction into the insurance space through a shared colleague who said, we need someone that has all of this technical knowledge in delivering construction projects to be able to be relatable to our customers in the insurance space. So back in 2014, I made a decision to change roles from that project manager to a technical support role on the risk side with one of the larger insuring carriers in the marketplace, AXA XL. They offer multiple lines of insurance, one of them being subcontractor default insurance. So I was able to cut my teeth over there in the insurance space and learn what it took to be a support role versus a leading role, which is very different in construction, and support their subcontractor default business. Doing that for a time, I was approached by Hudson, the opportunity to lead a smaller but more focused book of business in the sub-default space. Been doing that for a couple of years here. It's been unique. Think about it. It's all sticks, bricks, and mortar. Every construction project site you walk past, there's steel over here, cast in place, wood frame. Everyone gets there a little bit differently. And that's been sort of an awakening experience for me in this role. And we're able to use that cross-section experience to share what we feel are industry best practices, the common blind spots. There's still a lot of those, even with the best management and control. And then that consistent ability to give feedback and try to create rising tides and bring the industry up.
That's great, Bill. And for those of us listening in who maybe aren't as familiar, maybe we'll take a step back. Could you just elaborate on what SDI is, subcontractor default insurance? What does that entail?
Absolutely, Mike. So thank you for asking that. I kind of just make the assumption everyone knows what subcontractor default insurance is, but I know when I'm in personal company and I tell someone I'm a subcontractor default insurance loss control specialist, they kind of look at you like you have three heads. So sub-default insurance is an alternative to traditional performance security payment performance bonds. The relationship is just a little bit differently, but it is performance security at the end of the day. So in a traditional performance security, a subcontractor is asked to provide a bond, they get that bond, and the obligee is the general contractor or whoever the prime is. And in the event of a default, the bonding company indemnifies them and will step in and provide support to complete. The relationship in sub-default insurance is a little bit differently. It's an insurance product which the general contractor has with traditional deductibles and copays. but allows them to remedy a default situation should a subcontractor default. The key thing there is when you think about underwriting differently from bonding to subcontractor default insurance is when in sub bonds, the underwriter is the bonding agent between the subcontractor and SDI. The underwriter technically is the GC doing prequalification and the vetting of their subcontractor to try to mitigate and ultimately avoid a default from happening.
Excellent. Yeah, it's a little more hands-on in the process, right? A little more involved. And Bill, so I know you had said when you came from AXA over to Hudson, you know, you got the opportunity to have a very focused team, but that's not all Hudson does, correct?
Correct. Hudson is very unique in that they are a niche insurance provider. So subcontractor default insurance is very niche. There are only six carriers in the marketplace. And so that's a very specialized product versus where if you went out and bought casualty, you can get that from any number of dozens of carriers. So Hudson supports the niche marketplace. So they also do crop insurance, med mal, very unique tailored business lines. And what that does is allow us to be specialist in the one business that we support is we're really, you know, we're focused on it, we're passionate about it, and we want to make sure that we're supporting the insureds in the marketplace that think it's a really good risk management tool for their business.
Yeah. And Bill, I know one of the things you focus on with your customers to help them manage risk is their prequalification of subcontractor process. And as we get into some of those essential elements, I'm just curious, how many prequal files have you reviewed in your career?
We're probably in the thousands, soon approaching the hundreds of thousands. It's been a really an awakening opportunity. You know, I'll rewind the clock again, 18 years, stepping into that operational role as an entry-level project engineer, standing at the fax machine, waiting for the paper pre-qualification to come through on the pre-rolled paper that you're trying to stretch out a little bit. Collecting hard paper files and you get bits and pieces of it and you're trying to use that to say, okay, yes, check, I got a prequal. And maybe there was a general review on capacity, capability, and financial health, but it wasn't really consistently done. But having that experience, you fast forward now 18 years later, the amount of technology being used to help make that process more efficient and more effective. And general contractors are pre-qualifying better than ever. I'll pause that by saying we still frequently find blind spots, but you can do that to anything if that's your sole focus. But that is our job, is to point out where those blind spots are and where they can be filled in or what's available there to support a potential enhancement. But we still see a varying degree of sophistication. I would like to say we don't see fax machines anymore, but that's been replaced by email. So we still do collect paper files. They still are out there. There are a lot of great platforms out there, and what we advocate for is finding one that fits with our partner's business. You know, they've got to find one that works. It's not our job to tell them which ones are the best or the worst.
And when we last spoke, Bill, you had mentioned there's usually two parts that you expect to see in a prequal file. Can you tell us a little bit about those two parts?
Yeah, I mean, most GCs have evolved to a set process and practice that really has two key elements, you know, a financial assessment and then an operational assessment. And usually they're done by different roles, but sometimes in a smaller organization, they're done by the same person. Again, the process has to fit the problem kind of scenario. But in that financial element, it's really based on the financial health of your subcontractor. You want to collect their balance sheets. Obviously, the best practice is audited financials, but those aren't always available. And then you set a tiered, what do you want the water level to be for a small, call it painting contractor? They might just have tax returns. But again, there's a process there to think about it. And you're looking at debt to equity, cash, line of credit, look at their surety capacity. Does that line out with the financials? There's a whole list of items you can assess. And really what you're trying to do is get a temperature check on, are they financially healthy and will they be able to have the wherewithal to deliver through your project that you're considering them for? So the financial stuff is very much more defined, metrically based, and ideally the best practice is arriving at a single and aggregate limit of award, just like a surety would. But in this case, as the GC being sort of the underwriter, what they think they can deliver. The tougher part, the one that we find more blind spots in, is that operational capacity. It's what is their largest past project? What is their average project size? What other work do they have out to bid right now? We're a business of personalities on top of that. You know, do they have the right management staff? Do they have the right supers and foremen? Have they done work for that GC before? And do they have an understanding of the operational components? You know, are they good with submittals? Are they good with schedule? Are they good with getting their payment applications in on time? That one still drives me crazy, by the way. We're a business of money and most subs can't do that well. So all of those things are operational directional indicators that you want to have also assessed and put them together. What I'm looking to do is that next evolution is to use it to drive the award. You do it usually for the low bidder. And yes, you know, both boxes are checked. There's a missed opportunity there. And we can talk about that a little bit further.
Okay. So Bill, you mentioned this process, how it's evolved over time. So what is the answer, right? We have a process that's been steadily improving, but like you said, there are still blind spots there. What do you think are some of the key elements with the risk management portfolio? How do we move that from driving the process as opposed to a checkbox?
Construction's a business of numbers. You know, ultimately, it's about delivering on a project in a set amount of time and a set budget. There's a lot of times where you'd like to say one takes more priority than the other, but the two are the two pillars of delivering a project. I'm doing some construction metaphors here, but when you think about building an arch, the cornerstone is subcontractor prequalification. And when you think about the sub-default insurance product, the cornerstone is prequalification, is getting that sub-risk assessment right. Because it's not just about the budget. It's not just about the schedule. Neither of those things matter when your subcontractors aren't able to perform as your project finishes late. And usually you have a budget crisis, if you will. Some issues are remedied. They still cost time. They still cost money. Sometimes they're catastrophic, which is where the performance security steps in. So when I think about where the industry needs to be driving is that it's not really just about the number. It's easy to get a bid tabulation sheet together and scope all of your bidders out against each other and say everyone has a complete scope and, you know, the low bidder is X and let's go with that. And then get the prequal to fit into that. I've had personal life experience, and I'll talk a little bit about that, and where hindsight's always 20/20. You have a loss, something occurs, you get through that tough experience, but you want to sit down and say, okay, let's look back and what could we have done a little differently? So what I think is you get that bid tabulation sheet, and that's really ultimately in the industry, what drives decision-making is the financial component. And I'll try to be generic and do this as well as possible. So you've got three bidders, bidder A, bidder B, bidder C. For ease of numbers, call it $1 million, $1 million, $1 million, and $1 million, $2 million. Bidder B is a known bidder. They've done a lot of work for the GC before, and they happen to be 10% higher in this case. Bidder C was sort of a throw-in bid. They might be a little further out. They might not have been interested in the job. But bidder A is a new bidder. They're low, they're aggressive, they want to get the work. And ultimately, they were, yep, that's the sub we're going to go with. They do a pre-qualification and say, yep, that's okay. They line out with each other. Well, ultimately, bidder A ended up failing to perform and costing significant dollars. So when you look back and you say, was there an opportunity to potentially avoid that loss? It could have been done if you had done the pre-qualification on bidder two. You would have seen that their financial assessment was significantly better than bidder A. Their operational performance was significantly better than bidder A. And had you put them on the bid tabulation sheet, and that's what I'll go to as the lowest hanging fruit, is put those directional indicators on your bid tabulation sheet, and it might visibly drive some different decision making and potentially said, okay, for a small amount, I could have chosen bidder two, who was a known commodity, better financial position, better operational position, and could have executed on this project, driven that decision versus supporting the decision is sort of what I'm getting at. You know, blurring professional and personal experiences. My wife's a math teacher, and I consistently hear her telling her students to show their work. I feel like that is a very important thing to consider in all of the things that you're going to make an effort on doing due diligence for. As you do all this due diligence for prequal, show that work. And I think the best way to do that is to put those items, those directional indicators, both financial and operational, on that bid tabulation sheet. It allows for a lot of things. It creates visible transparency that the process has actually happened. So that's the first is, are you executing that process? Secondly, it will help drive, in my opinion, some behavioral decision making is, okay, I've got all these numbers. That's great. The easiest thing is when you've got all those numbers on the bid tabulation sheet, you want to make those numbers mean something. So mm-hmm. I'll sort of use an analogy is you want the best possible fit for your project. And obviously it's got to fit within budget and it's got to fit within a number of other parameters. But really, when you think about it, you want the best fit. Think about when you go to a shoe store and you're going to buy a shoe. There's a lot of size 10 shoes. You're not just going to go walk up to one and say, that's my shoe because it fits. You know, it's the right size. There's comfort factors. Do you get right arch support? Do you get right heel support? You want it to be comfortable. And I think about using that same mindset when you're using a subcontractor decision. Just because it's in your budget, just because the size is correct, doesn't mean that it's the right fit. You've got to use a lot of those other directional indicators. What's their financial position? What's their work in progress? Do they have the right management and operational team? All of those other factors should be contemplated for the right fit. Just because it's in budget doesn't mean it's the right fit. Get that back into a foundational process. You can walk into any construction company right now. They all have a leveling sheet. It is a common task and industry accepted processes to put them all on that leveling sheet. And I think it's the easiest thing to do is to go in there and insert a few directional indicators that might provide a different paradigm for supporting a decision.
Bill, and I think that leading back to what you were mentioning here about driving the process, that way, correct me if I'm wrong here, but that really helps understand the process as a founder. So when something does happen, right, inevitably claims will happen. When you do get to that point, though, that really kind of brings you to a place where you can say, okay, now let's look back at what we've done. We understand maybe what were some red flags that we missed. Maybe there was something that we said that's a risk we're willing to take. It kind of helps bring you back to how you got off the tracks a little bit, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. And I've seen this spectrum. What I've seen is even with the best process and practice, there are things that get missed, unfortunately, and that's when loss occurs. And even when you've got a this is probably for a separate podcast. There's prequalification and then there's continuing qualification. Prequalification is a line in the sand. Subcontractors have things that happen in the day-to-day of delivering projects where their financial position can change from Monday to Friday. And those elements don't get captured in prequalification. So I don't want to make it seem like all loss is avoidable. It's not. Things happen. I mean, that's a great opportunity, I think, as a carrier when a default occurs is to provide relief to the general contractor. And I think we are, as an industry, trying to do better at that, is getting money and support to the insureds and the marketplace faster and when they're having a difficult time. But I think that always you should use that opportunity to look back and say, what was wrong? Did I miss something that I should have assessed, or did I assess it and not adequately address it? Or should I have taken a different approach to addressing the risk that I didn't know because it still failed? So it's an assessment of your own process and practice. You'll discover blind spots, you'll fill them in, and then there'll be new ones. But it's a continuing evolution.
Bill, I love the tip of adding pre-qualification data into your bid leveling form. If you read Autodesk's Construction Outlook, bidding is up 36% in January. That means if I'm a contractor, I'm getting 7, 8, 9 bids. How deep do you recommend contractors go when they have 7 or 8 bidders? Do they do pre-qual on all, just a portion? What are your thoughts there?
You know, it's a great question, Peter. Timing is always something that has to be contemplated. It's easy to say, you know, in negotiated work, you've got a little bit more leniency during that period to do some discovery of your bid opportunities. Like, who are the subs I'm going to reach out to? Do I have prior history with them? Do you at least have some prior files from pre-qualification that an easier task is to just get an update? But those new to market subs or subs you haven't done work with that you don't have files on, absolutely, it's a process to go through an entire pre-qualification if it's not really a viable subcontractor, one that's going to be competitive. So I always go to at least having some understanding of that subcontractor from an operational capacity before you let them bid is, have they done projects of this size? Have they done projects of this nature with competitors of yours? At least some of those directional indicators that they can have operational understanding. But absolutely, the absolute necessity, though, is to understand their financial position if they are competitive before you move to award. So best practice is to have full prequalification before bid. That's not always practical, but an absolute hard line in the sand is to have prequalification completed before you're considering award. So you might get that number in. If they're not super competitive, you're not going to go that next step. But if they are super competitive, you've got to hit the brakes, get through the process, collect all that information, and then again, use it to drive the decision. It's absolutely paramount that you have prequalification done before consideration to award.
Bill, if I'm a risk manager or CFO, what's in it for me? Why make the change?
As a risk manager and CFO, you know, those jobs are typically looked at as protecting the net worth and the reputation of the company. And as performance security is a tool to do that. And performance security is typically, there's all elements baked into it. It's all encompassing of the life cycle of a project, from subcontractor selection to delivery of the work. But when you think about a sub-default product, for alignment reasons, there's significant deductibles and significant co-pays, is it allows the insured control. They can go in and remedy a sub-default. But at that same time, it allows you to minimize that overall impact, is you get to step in and say, okay, I want to make sure that we don't lose schedule, so you can get a replacement trade contractor in there. I want to protect my budget as I can manage payments to my defaulted subcontractor. And ultimately, you can demonstrate to your owner that you do have control of the project. So as a risk manager and CFO, the controls associated with sub-default insurance before and during a claim, they return control. And what you ultimately end up with is protecting your reputation, protecting your project's health. It's good alignment for supporting control of your business.
Excellent point. And Bill, having walked through some of those great tips, I guess a question I would ask you, what should we have asked you that we didn't?
A lot of times you get the question, do you think technology has sort of answered all the problems? And I think that the answer would be relatable on all levels of life, not just prequalification. It's absolutely enhanced it, but it hasn't solved all of the problems. Even the best platforms out there still have blind spots. There's reasons for that. Maybe they tie in with some bidding softwares. Maybe they have a high risk threshold that doesn't align with your business. They are a tool. They aren't the solution. They are a tool. So I do think that technology is good, but I don't think it has addressed all the issues.
Excellent point, Bill. And listeners, I'm sure, are going to put some action items together for that. But I want to switch gears briefly here. You've had an interesting career from contractor to insurance carrier. Tell me, where are you still growing as a professional?
So sort of mentioned it earlier when I did the rewind reel, is standing in front of the fax machine. The fax machine is I think we kind of all laugh now when we see one. The evolution over my career in technology has been exponential. Even during that time while I was at Whiting Turner, the evolution in the ERP systems was occurring. You leave that, the general contractor space, come to the carrier space, and you get this ability to see the spectrum of ERPs that were actually even out there and how they've evolved to be more user-friendly. The industry as a whole has come a long way in the time I've been in it, and we're doing a lot more with a lot less, candidly. Owners are asking for more to be completed with less staff. They obviously want to drive their costs down, and the way you get those efficiencies is technology, candidly. And it's moving at such a rapid pace. It's been something really hard to keep up with, but it's also been something that's been incredibly fascinating and energizing, is that we're doing all of these things now with technology. And it's not just in sub-default with the prequal platforms. It's in all of the other risk areas of construction. You think about safety. There's these technologies out there that can scan the room and find a hazard, or there's quality. We're doing things now with drones and sensors, and the technology has been incredibly fascinating, but it's also maddening to keep up with. But it's something that I struggle to keep up with, but also have a lot of energy and excitement around it. So something that I keep tabs on and look for further advancement. It's always one of the answers I go to is if you're not using technology, find a solution. It will absolutely make you more efficient and effective. And then teach me about it so that I can know more.
That's excellent, Bill. And so tell our listeners, what is something, maybe kind of shifting gears again, like Peter said a little bit, what is something that our listeners may be surprised to hear about you?
Oh, man. So, you know, we loss control specialist. I'm a loss control specialist in my personal life, too. I live in the greater Hartford area now, but I didn't grow up here. I grew up in Buffalo. And what most people know about people that grow up from Buffalo is they bleed blue when it comes to sports. You've got the Bills and the Sabres. So I'm also a loss control specialist in my personal life. Neither of those teams, sans the Bills last year, but for the most part of the best 20 years is they've been really good loss specialists, not loss control specialists. The Sabres this year, not so hot, but I'm hopeful for next year. We just talked about the draft earlier. Let's see what next year brings, but I'm a loss control specialist in my personal and professional life.
Right. Yeah. Now that guy Brady's down in Florida and hopefully retiring soon, maybe we all get a chance at winning a few games this year.
Yeah, I don't know. That guy just doesn't seem to want to quit. And I admire that.
Yep. Yep. All right. And so, Bill, wrapping this up a little bit here, you may have noticed that the podcast is called The Building Bites. That is BIM insurance technology with the experts, you being the expert. So we like to ask our audience, you know, and our guests, what are you taking a bite out of today? You mentioned Hartford. So I know that's the pizza capital of the world. Is that what's on the menu?
New Haven. So we're only a stone's throw from New Haven. And I think Barstool Sports said it. The pizza mecca is New Haven. And I don't disagree. So definitely you got to get there and try the trifecta. You've got to get Pepe's, Sally's, and Modern and make the decision for yourself. But I would also recommend doing them that order. I'm sure some of the listeners may debate that, and that's totally fine as long as those three are on your list. We're good. But I'll also say, outside of the pizza mecca of the world, me and my family we're avid outdoors folks. We like to go hiking. We recently went up to New Hampshire. If anyone's up in that neck of the woods, I found the best pancake joint in the world. You reach out, I'll let you know where it is. I do want to keep it sort of a hidden secret, though. So for any of the listeners that end up in the White Mountains of New Hampshire, let me know and I'll put you onto it.
A selfish pancake eater. Interesting. Bill, thank you so much for chatting with us today. If the listeners want to hook up with you, want to reach out to you, where can they find you?
LinkedIn is obviously a great business networking tool to connect with me on LinkedIn, but always available via cell and happy to answer any industry questions. My cell is 203-800-5207. And I absolutely welcome some engagement from the marketplace. I might wear a Hudson jersey and support our insureds as a primary purpose, but rising tides raises all boats. And I think as an industry, we've come a long way. I still see a lot of opportunity to raise the tide and fill in some of those blind spots and elevate the industry to be more efficient, more effective.
Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Michael. Appreciate you guys having me today. This is incredible and look forward to talking with you guys again soon.
Thank you for listening to The Building Bite. This podcast has been brought to you by Proactive. Check us out on thebuildingbite.com, where you can subscribe to our newsletter and follow us on social media for all future The Building Bite news and updates. You can also find us on your favorite apps, including Apple and Google Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, TuneIn, and Amazon. If you have ideas for episode topics that we should cover on the show, or you know somebody who would be a perfect guest, let us know at connect@thebuildingbite.com.